People, of course, claim there is an international community which should help the Syrian, but there is no such international community because we see that there is a conflict between the Russian and Chinese and the Americans and the French. That's because what the American and the French call the international and the British call the international community is in fact a one-sided intervention policy in the internal affairs of other states in violation of the UN Charter in practice or at least in spirit. It depends one from case to case. But they have, under the guise of human rights, they have simply decided that the UN Charter is kaput and bankrupt and we can just dismiss it and we can intervene whenever we decide that it's their human rights violation. That's what I don't agree with. I mean, even though we could think of situations where intervention might be necessary, maybe even humanitarian intervention, there is a question of who is going to intervene. You see, if Russia was to intervene in Bahrain, for example, to protect the population, there would be a world war. So in fact, if there is no world war, it's because Russia accepts not to intervene in Bahrain. So, but on the other hand, the West thinks that because it represents human rights, has a right to intervene anywhere, and that's very destabilizing because, you see, every minority or every rebel group anywhere, we now, after Yugoslavia, basically after Kosovo, they will decide that if they can frame the issue not as a political issue or as a separatist issue or whatever, but they can frame it as a human rights issue, then they can get the Western powers to come militarily at its to support it. And that's very destabilizing, I'm sorry. I mean, I think certain things should change, and I think things are changing in Syria as far as I can tell. They have dismantled a one-party state, they will have elections, whether the elections will be fair or not, that's a question. But of course, the elections have not been fair in the West throughout the ages. I mean, it takes time, and building up a democracy takes time, and the question is whether we should do it by intervening violently through our bombing or whether we should let the process evolve. I think we should let the process evolve. I mean, if we see the result in Iraq and in Libya and in Afghanistan, I don't think our bombing is doing any good. Mm-hmm. It must be said that if you look at the history of Latin America, of Franco Spain, of Portugal with Salazar, the Greek colonel, Eastern Europe, Indonesia and several African countries, you see that many countries have undergone a democratization process without foreign intervention in an internal way. So I found it a bit extraordinary, this belief that in the case of Syria and Libya, such a democratization process could not be done internally. Or in the case of Iraq and so on, and it has only to be done by external intervention and bombing. Okay? Mm-hmm. It should also be realized that the only thing we do, in fact, is bombing, because we don't have troops. In the colonial period, there was a coherence. You could send troops, then you administer the country, then you develop it, you exploit it, but you develop it to some extent. I mean, there was a project which had some coherence, but now we don't have the troops. We don't want to send kids to die in foreign lands, and certainly Europeans don't want to do that. The Americans are barely able to do that, so the colonial period is over, but then we say, okay, let's go and bomb, because that's the only thing we can still do. Okay? And if a country builds up a sufficiently anti-aircraft defense system, a DCA, then we don't want to bomb them, and that's maybe the situation in Syria. So, I mean, there is something completely crazy to this interventionist policy. And of course, moreover, when there is a democracy, then we go in and buy one party. We give money to one party, which is called Democrat. I don't know why the others are not Democrats. The others are running in elections too. And why are some parties Democrat and some not Democrat? They are simply subservient to the Western interest or not. I mean, this is just destroying democracy where it exists and bombing to produce it where it doesn't exist. I mean, this is absurd. And this is a policy which, I must say, is supported by the vast majority of human rights organizations, of so-called Democrats and of so-called left, and I think it's absurd. So, I mean, one has to analyze things very concretely, and not think it's a conspiracy of the oil company or a whole Jewish conspiracy and so on. I don't believe in conspiracies. I'm looking at the facts one by one, okay? There's a dynamics also which has taken over the West of human rights interventionism, which is neither pro-capitalist nor, I mean, where the Zionist lobby has played a role, but the human rights movement has been a sort of sidetracked, I would say, which I'm not against the human rights per se, but I'm against the sidetracking of the human rights towards war propaganda. And then, of course, there's also the military-industrial complex, which is pushing towards more armament, and more armaments may mean sometimes more war. But I think the causes of war has to be case. It's won by. There is no general formula that explains why war occurs. That's what I think. What I do question is the wiseness of our policy of arming the opposition and denying from the start the possibility of a political transition, which is obviously, you know, honestly or not honestly, but there is a political process going on in the country, and I think there has to be one. I think China and Russia do support the political process, in fact, and I think we should either cooperate with the rest of the world in supporting the political process or not intervene at all. But this whole idea that we're going to arm the rebels because the civilian population is being butchered by the tyrant and so on, that I don't believe that story. Since are the aggressors, where do they aggress anybody? That's a funny thing. You see, even if you complain about the behavior in Chechnya or Tibet, these are within their borders. I don't see any Chinese soldier abroad, for example. And the Russians have withdrawn from Eastern Europe, so I don't know where they are aggressors. Again, I think it's very important that we make a distinction between internal affairs and external affairs if we are to preserve world peace, because there is no suggestion from the human rights crowd of how to preserve world peace in a world where everybody can intervene everywhere. If they like intervention, then they should tell me why Russia has no right to intervene in Bahrain, to support the population against the tyrant, and if they want that, then they have to realize they're going to have a general war. You know, even if you now challenge the war propaganda, you immediately call a revisionist or a negationist and a Holocaust denier and so on, and you can't even get, at least in France, you can't get the word in edgewise. And that's a tragedy, because that of course refers then to free speech, which is also something which is put in the wastebasket by the humanitarian, the human rights people. And that is of course the transformation to which we should adapt, but we don't adapt ourselves, and our whole idea of intervention blinds us to the necessity of adapting ourselves to a world which is not dominated by the West, which it has been for centuries, but it's no longer and will never be again, and it will be less and less. And that's the main problem of our time. When I speak of non-intervention, I think more broadly, how are we going to live in a world that we don't have all these people working for us at low wages and producing, you know, raw materials, etc. This is going to end up eventually, and we'll have to adapt to that. Because you see, the problem is, in the end, you see, well, in the case of the European countries, there is a question of more of dignity than really economic interest, because we don't wage very expensive wars. But the United States, certainly in the United States, there is a whole movement, including a conservative movement like Ron Paul and so on, who say, look, we don't get anything from these wars. It costs us a fortune. It bankrupts our economy and so on. And so we don't want no more wars. Okay? But it's interesting that as opposed to the Vietnam War, there is an opposition to the war both on the left and on the right. And there's a center which regroups people who are very much on the right, in my view, namely the Zionists and the neoconservatives, and the humanitarian left. That's funny. So the left-right divide, the thing which is confusing in nowadays is that the left-right divide is, I wouldn't say it doesn't exist, but it's not what it used to be, in the sense that there is a very right-wing movement and a left movement who are agreeing on interventionism, and there's a very right-wing movement, a very left-wing movement who are against interventionism, and the debate about interventionism is not the border, the left-right border, you see? Because you see, once you declare the war, then you have the patriotic feeling, you're all to, you know, get around the flag, and now the flag is the one of human rights, but before it was the nation, it was the country, and so on. I just challenge that. I think there should be alternative to wars, and of course the first way to start that is to demilitarize, to develop the diplomacy instead of threats and so on. I mean, we're always bullying people everywhere. You see Mrs. Clinton coming all over the place, whatever the conflict, the United States want this, and the people have the right to this and that. And, okay, where does the authority come from to decide everywhere what has to be done? You see, she claims she has a solution to every problem, from Sri Lanka to Somalia and so on, but that's not true. I mean, let's look at where they intervene and let's look at what the results are. Are they so great? They complain, they say, okay, I don't know whether figures are right, 10,000 people dead in Syria. Okay, that's tragic. How many people dead in Iraq compared to that? Far more, hundreds of thousands probably. And how many refugees? So that's a result of intervention. So you have to give me an argument that intervention is better than non-intervention. These people, Israel and the West, and they are sort of allied against secular nationalist regime, but probably it's a game of fools, because it's not clear that they all have the same agenda. Okay, so So, for example, in Libya, it's not so clear that the West has won, because in the end, who wins there is not so clear. If the country is unstable, it's not so clear that that's a good thing, again, from a capitalist point of view. And but it's clear that Qatar and Saudi Arabia have an ideological agenda, religious agenda, and they are this, and they are supporting this Islamist movement a little bit everywhere. So the situation is complicated. You can't say that the war against Islam, because Iraq, Syria, Libya, or secular regime. No, I think, you know, the situation, of course, look, in every war that I know of, when the country who is waging the war is in a winning situation, the people who are against the war are always in a weak situation, and they are always being demonized, etc. You know, Bertrand Russell, for example, who is somebody I greatly admire, was opposed throughout the war to World War I. But when the war ended, he wasn't very happy, because he saw the same crowd that were rejoicing in England, of course, at the end of the war, he saw that they were the same crowd that 4 years before were rejoicing at the beginning of the war. And of course, the problem there with the victor is that they imposed the Versailles Treaty, and then, as predicted by Keynes, then that led to another war. And it was something, you know, you have to understand that our side is winning, the anti-war movement is always in a weak situation, because that was the case throughout history. When people are, to some extent, nationalist, and when they win, it's like their soccer team is winning, and you know, mm-hmm. there's nothing you can do about it. But of course, when the situation is getting more difficult, like it is apparently in Syria, and it'll probably be with Iran, then of course people start to think about alternative to wars. Okay. It used to be nationalism, now the nationalism of the West has become the human rights business, but there's still this sentiment, you know, we're going to civilize the savages and so on through war. And so it's only when things go badly that people mm-hmm. start to think. But things do badly, go badly between Israel and its neighbors, things go badly, I think, with Iran, maybe with Syria, I still don't know how it's going to come out. But of course mm-hmm. it went badly in Afghanistan, so the people start to think. So the anti-war movement is not, it's dead, it has self-destructed itself with humanitarian intervention, but of course it doesn't mean that it's not mm-hmm. going to be revived in some sense.